other for a long time. I thought that your experience would be really interesting for our audience. So you've done something really quite special and something that a lot of people aspire to do, want to do, but actually they don't manage to. So tell us a bit about your story. Start pre-day one.
Pre-day
talk,
one.
Talk to us a bit about the build-up. In fact, what is it that you've done?
So I decided to give up alcohol for a year. That was my original challenge to myself, to see whether I could actually do it. I was inspired by an article that I saw on Bored Panda, which was before and after photos, which I have mentioned in some of my posts. And I was just amazed at how people looked before and after giving up drinking. And whilst I didn't think I looked that bad, I knew I was overweight, I knew I was unhappy, and I knew I was drinking too much. So I set myself a challenge, and the challenge was supposed to start on New Year's Eve 2016 to 2017, so the one just gone. But it didn't quite turn out like that, because I got ill just before, well, it was in the end of November, and I ended up with flu, and so I had to stop drinking because I was just literally floored, and then I just carried it on from there. So my year started the 27th of November 2016.
Okay. So tell me about the lead up to that. What was going on for you that made you think that you needed to stop drinking?
I was arranging to go out on Friday and then not arranging anything for the rest of the weekend because I knew that I would be out, I'd be out late, I'd be sick the next day. I would literally finish work on a Friday and drink myself stupid. I was in a relationship which was absolutely rubbish, not being treated very well at all. And when I look back, I've been in my job for a long time, 10 to 11 years, and I was probably a bit bored, although I couldn't see it at the time, so I think that was kind of stressing me out. So I think there was lots of different stress elements, which was leading me to drinking. And so, yeah, Friday night, I was smoking then as well, so I was smoking, binge drinking, and then being sick, and then binge eating. Once I felt a bit better, and then repeating that again. So I wasn't drinking every day, it was more drinking at the weekend, but my weekend generally started on Thursday night. So yeah, it was just drinking to excess in small, well, long spaces of time, but rather than drinking every day, I just drank all my quota in one, basically.
Yeah, with some change buds. So what was the moment of epiphany? What was the point in which you realised, actually this is harmful, I've had enough of it, I'm making bad choices?
I had a bit of a drunk texting incident with the ex, which just absolutely scared the life out of me. I'd already thought that I was going to be giving up drinking on New Year's Eve anyway. This happened in November, and it just scared the life out of me. I just didn't recognise myself. I don't consider myself to be a really nasty person. I was pretty vile. And you know, or when you're texting, you've got all that information there the next day when you kind of come to, and I just was really upset with myself with what I'd done. So that was a pinnacle, and then the weekend I actually gave up was a weekend away with friends, which is drinking from Friday to Sunday. And yeah, my eczema was really bad. I've suffered from with eczema since I was five, which is nearly all cleared up now. And it was really bad that weekend. I'd already been to the doctor, and the doctor had given me different medication, not strong enough, so the medication wasn't helping. I was drinking, smoking, yeah, just a mess really. And so on that Sunday, really hungover, came home, and luckily, I suppose, I got the flu, so it began then.
So how would you alluded to it, but how would you describe your mental health at that time?
I wouldn't have said that I had a mental issue as such, but looking back, I think my brain was all over the place. I think one thing that I have thought is that I thought I was over-emotional, which I'm sure as a friend you know that I can be sometimes, but it was induced by alcohol. I think without alcohol, I'm pretty level-headed. I don't get as angry. I certainly don't cry. I was known as the crier as well. I don't cry very much at all. And yet I was probably crying at least once or twice a week about absolutely nothing. So my moods have levelled out, my emotions have levelled out, and that was one thing that I just didn't, well, there's lots of things about being sober I didn't anticipate, but I didn't realise there'd be such a massive shift.
And what you've done is a huge lifestyle change, and a lot of our audience have done a similar thing. You know, I've done the same thing with alcohol, whether it's under-eating, over-eating, giving up drinking, smoking, or making a positive change towards something else. But what are some of the challenges that you faced?
My social life has changed massively, because obviously it revolved totally around drinking. Whether it was going for a drink after work, Friday night was drinking, Saturday was drinking, you know, I didn't really go out and do a lot without alcohol being involved. So then you kind of think, well, what do I do if I'm not drinking? And one thing I don't really like doing anymore is hanging out in pubs, and that was probably what I would do on a Friday. I don't mind going to pubs for lunch. As long as there's food involved, I'm there. But if it's just a drinking event, it doesn't inspire me anymore, unfortunately. So my friendship group has kind of changed a bit, because I'm meeting more people who are sober, and it's sometimes easier to hang out with people that are thinking the same as you. Because I don't want to be somebody that is a pain that, oh God, Dawn's coming and she's sober, and all she's going to whinge on about is, oh, look at how many calories there are in that glass of wine, or that glass of wine's going to do this to you. I'm trying not to do that, but I see alcohol as a very negative thing now. I don't see any positives in it at all. I'm fine with people having one or two, but if it's an all-night thing, you won't see me there anymore. No.
And how have other people's attitudes changed? What's the feedback and response you've had from people?
Pretty amazing. I mean, the blog that I write has gone from strength to strength. I've met loads of people through that site. My own friends, I think some people have struggled a little bit. You know, it's almost like the old Dawn's gone and new one's in her place. So I'm very conscious that some people have found it difficult. But most, yeah, 98% of people have been very, very positive about it. Because I think alcohol affects everybody, whether it's somebody that you know that drinks too much, or you drink too much, or you have drunk too much. You know, alcohol really has touched everybody's lives in some way. So it's an interesting, for me, I think it's been a fascinating subject. I thought I would just give up drinking, but that's not what it's about. It's changing your entire lifestyle. It's, everything has changed for me. Nothing is the same as it was before.
Okay, tell me more about that. What's changed? How has it changed?
Well, my job changed at the same time, which was a really, really positive thing, because obviously alcohol is a lot to do with triggers. And I think if I was still working in my old job, that was a much larger company, there was more social events involved, there's more people to interact with. So I think it would have been a big trigger, whereas I've never drunk at the job whilst working where I'm working now, so that trigger's immediately gone. I'm just trying to think now, I'm saying everything's changed.
Can I help you sleep?
Oh my God, my sleep is just, my sleep is absolutely amazing. Before, I would be going to bed early and I'd want to wake up late. I just felt sluggish all the time, my sleep was interrupted. Now, I get very tired about 10 o'clock, literally on the dot. I'm like a battery, and once I run out, have to go to bed, and then wake up really early. And I don't have any desire to go back to sleep, but that's the one thing that's massively changed. Because before I'd be sneezing, you know, I'd probably sneeze my phone about 10 times before I'd actually get up. So now what I do is get up and walk in the morning. So I'm walking every day at the moment. I'm doing a challenge with it's called Race at Your Pace. So I have to fit in my miles. I know everybody knows about that on my blog, because I write about it quite a lot, but it's a fantastic idea that you sign up for a challenge and you have to complete that challenge within a month. So in July, I set myself a challenge to walk 200 miles, which I completed. For August, I'm doing 150. I thought I'd give myself a bit of a break. It's still hardcore. So I'm walking between 5 and 7 miles every morning before work. So that involves getting up 6:30 at the latest I can leave. It's more like leaving at 6, walking the miles, coming back, getting ready again to work. So that's, yeah, I never used to do much, did I? I didn't really like to move. My diet, obviously, I was very overweight. I've dieted my whole life. Since I was 16, I've done every diet you can think of, but this time it's working. And that is mainly because I used to celebrate any weight loss years over the years with having a bottle of wine. So I'd go to the slimming club that I belong to, lose a pound, drink a bottle of wine. So yeah, that's massively changed because I don't do that anymore. And the weight has fallen off, so I've lost nearly 3 stone
wow,
since January.
Congratulations.
Yeah, thank you. And it's staying off and it keeps coming off. I keep getting addicted to other little things like curly whirlies, magnums, sweet things, which is totally normal.
Sugar. Anything with sugar.
Yeah.
I'm still 5 and a bit years on, still crave sugar.
Yeah.
That has never dissipated, it's never gone.
And I'm not going to beat myself up over that. That's the thing, is every time I have a magnum, I think, I walked 7 miles this morning, so I deserve it. It's all about the deserving. And also, I'm not drinking, and I still deserve treats. But yeah, the Magnum thing did, the curly whirly thing got out of control for a while, and then the Magnum thing got out of control for a while, and now I'm just waiting for the next thing to come along. Because there's always going to be something, but I'm working hard in other respects. So it's all about the balance, really.
Yeah, it is. So what about mental health? How has that changed now? Now you're alcohol
free? I just feel amazing. I really do feel amazing. I don't worry about a lot. I don't beat myself up a lot. I know I said in one of my blogs, I never believed the saying, love yourself. You know, what's that all about, really?
You never believed it?
No,
right.
Because I just thought it sounded a bit big-headed, oh, I love myself, kind of thing. But now I'm beginning to see exactly what it means, that if you do look after yourself, I care about myself, you know, I care the fact that I've got to get up and walk, and I've got to do these things to make myself feel better. Whereas I didn't understand that before, I thought I was going to find it in the bottom of a bottle. I thought I was finding it in the bottom of a bottle, but actually that was really making me sad. And my habit of drinking would be drinking, probably first glass was, well, yeah, I feel fine. Second one, the emotions start coming in, the beating yourself up, you're not good enough for this, you're not good enough for that. You know, you let people treat you a certain way, and whilst you're doing that, you're just upsetting yourself. Nobody else is upset, you're just upsetting yourself, and I've just stopped upsetting myself. I'm just happy, just, you know, life's not a bad thing. Life is a good thing. You just have to make the right choice, and alcohol is not the right choice for me.
Mm. Did you ever consider just cutting down, going back to
a
more moderate way of drinking? Or
no. My views on moderation are that if I could moderate, wouldn't I have already moderated?
Mm.
God, we know what, you know, let's have a drink. I don't think in my life I've ever had a drink. Probably 5 times, you know, and probably because I was driving. Even then I couldn't really be bothered because what is the point in one? You know, it's got to be a session if it's going to be worth anything. You know, one question that I get asked a lot is, would you not have like a toast at a wedding?
Yeah, I get asked that as well.
It's always about a toast at the wedding.
That's an alcohol-free glass of champagne without alcohol.
it's really strange,
yeah,
isn't it?
It is strange.
Or a buck's fizz at Christmas, or a glass of wine. If I was to have anything, I'd have a glass of red with a roast dinner. That's what I think about if I think about something that I'd probably like to have. But it has never been a glass of red wine with a roast dinner. It's been 2 bottles, a hangover. What did I eat? You know, don't know what I ate for dinner because I was too busy drinking. Did I care about the food? No. So there is no point in me doing that. I mean, the idea of the experiment for a year was that when I started, it was going to be on New Year, so that the next New Year I could get completely hammered. When I then started in November, I then said, oh, this is great. If I start in November, I could get pissed all next Christmas. That was my original thought plan. And now the thought of getting pissed at Christmas is just like very, very far removed from what I want to be. I don't ever, ever want to be like that again.
Mm. So how have you done it? You know, what have you had to draw on in terms of your draw on?
Well, I mean, the blog has been amazing. I think writing stuff down for me, I didn't realise before how therapeutic it is. When you're writing stuff down, it's getting it out from you, it's putting it onto the paper, and it's kind of making, you know, that's made me feel a lot better.
So that was cathartic, was it?
Yeah.
Doing it
Yeah, but also other people, I think one thing from the blog that people say is, oh my God, I'm not on my own. You know, I think we've all sat at home going,
poor me. Have you heard that?
Yeah, I have. That's exactly what it is. And you're just like, you know, crying. I think we're all very good at making excuses. I always said I didn't have enough time for exercise. You do have time. If you don't get pissed the night before and you go to bed early, you actually feel all right and you actually feel quite energetic when you wake up. And I'm not saying that you'll feel like that on day one, because you won't. You'll feel crap on day one, but you know, you will eventually feel better. The other thing that people want is instant gratification, that you're going to feel all right. The minute you put down that wine bottle, you're going to feel all right. You're not. It takes months to feel all right. You know, I would say at 90 days, I was really euphoric, but the first 3 months are not easy. You know, you stay in a lot. You don't hang out with your friends very much. You feel a bit of a hermit. You feel that you're a bit on your own. You really are on your own when you're sober. You know, if you thought you were on your own when you're pissed, well, you're really on your own when you're sober, and you have to get your head around that. You have to get your head around the fact that, you know, if you really want this enough, there aren't any excuses. You know, there are enough hours in the day. You can do it. You might need help to do it, but you all of us have it in us to do it if we really want it bad enough, I think.
Yeah, I agree. I think that's the absolute thing. You've got to have had enough, whatever that behaviour is.
And really want it.
But I think as well, looking at some of the things that feed into, you know, thinking of some of the people I work with, they're self-medicating against some pain.
Yeah.
Or a situation, like they're in a job which is deeply unfulfilling and lacks authenticity, you know, in relation to who they are. What was your pain? What were you drinking on, if you like? What were you trying to mask or to heal or to resolve?
It's a good question, because I've been asked that a lot, and I don't see it as any one thing. I don't see it. I didn't have a major trauma that, you know, that I would think about. You know, some people who have written to me do have massive things that they don't want to think about, and I understand that. I don't really know. I think it was just massive unhappiness in myself. I didn't feel worthy. I didn't feel, you know, it's a catch 22. You feel unhappy about yourself, so you drink, which ultimately makes you feel worse. And I think that's the thing. I read a lot of people saying, this happened to me today, this awful thing happened to me today, so I picked up a drink. And now what I think is, well, that was really the worst thing you could have done, because that's what I did. Oh, I've had a bad day. I'll pick up a bottle of wine. And I just felt, you know, it just made the whole situation much worse. Obviously, everybody's situation is different, but generally, I don't think alcohol helps a bad situation.
No.
I think it really makes it worse. I think it makes you more anxious. It makes you much more upset. Irrationally thinking about the situation, whereas in the cold light of day you might be able to think about it better. I understand there are some situations in which you do need to numb the pain, but I think you need to numb it in a different way. You know, seek counselling. You know,
that's not numbing; it's resolving.
Resolve well, and that's
the unresolved pain leads to addictive and dangerous and damaging behaviours, I think. And that pain needs to be resolved. All that junk needs to be left.
But it's very easy to say, and like, again, those things take. I think our society expects instant change. I've made the decision. Right, tomorrow it's going to be okay tomorrow. It's not going to be okay tomorrow. You know, I'm nearly 9 months in, and still every day things happen. You know, I'm doing this. I didn't. You know, when I woke up this morning, I didn't expect to be doing this or talking about this. So things change very quickly. But also, you know, you've got to be patient with yourself. You know, your body's taken years and years of damage. It's not going to right itself overnight. You know, I get asked a lot about the sleep side of things, and it will sort itself out, but it's not going to be quick. And especially if you've got something that is causing you pain, you know, that's not going to help your sleep situation either, but you know, that's where you need to start dealing with the thing that's causing you the problem.
Yeah, undoubtedly. I mean, I think that you're right. I mean, the thing that's causing the issue can still be manifesting itself. You just aren't masking it anymore. Actually, you're more exposed and more vulnerable. Do you have bad days?
Yeah, I had a really bad weekend. It was Glastonbury weekend, and I'd celebrated 6 months, and I'd been like, woo, yay, 6 months, you know, 6 months feels good. But after 6 months, you're kind of like, oh my God, that's it. This is it. I've made the decision. I've told the world I'm never going to have a drink again. And I was watching Glastonbury. Well, I couldn't really watch most of it because I was just like, oh my God, everybody's having a good time and I'm never going to have a good time again. You know, I'm never going to have that. Because I've been to a few festivals and to be honest, I was in a complete state. I've been to four, I think. Complete state at all of them. Which I wouldn't want to repeat. But I still find it difficult to believe that I'm ever going to have such a good a time without alcohol. So Glastonbury was on the TV and I got really down, cried like most of the weekend, just felt really, really unhappy. Because it is a massive change and you know, you're going to miss things. It's a relationship at the end of the day. It's like having a boyfriend that it was nice to you for 20 odd years of your life and then started turning into a bit of a git and you're not going to forget the good times that you had. But when things start going bad, you have to question whether you want that relationship in your life anymore. So yeah, it wasn't great. But then, I think the other thing is that when you're sober, you expect every day to be buoyant and amazing. And that's not real life. You know, it's not always going to be amazing. I guess the next soberversary will be my year, which is in November, and then what happens? What happens?
It becomes normal.
You stop counting,
and yeah, it just becomes your normal.
Yeah.
That said, yeah, I've sat in groups of people who've talked about I was sober 28 years, and then I just
petrifies me.
But what I'm saying is, it's something that whilst I say it becomes normal, you cannot become complacent. No. You still have to remind yourself why you're doing this and keep an eye on certain situations, subtle little signs that you might, I just had a look at your euphoric recall there. No, wasn't that great when we did that? You have to be careful you don't have too much euphoric recall.
Yeah.
Glorifying and glamorising and normalising that kind of behaviour, and it's not normal to drink to excess.
No.
It really isn't, since, I kind of thought that
we did ours in a short space of time, didn't we?
We did, we went to 20 years and that. No. Yeah. I mean, you mentioned triggers earlier. Do you still have triggers that you're really hyper aware of? The festival, obviously.
They're getting better. The main one was the sun, when the sun came out.
Yes.
I think that got everybody. I mean, all over social media, it got everyone. You know, whether it was a barbecue, whether it was sitting in the pub garden. You know, we thought, God, there's nothing better, is there? You know, you go and sit, this is how I glamorise it. And you sit there with the ice bucket and the bottle of wine and it's all amazing. But two or three bottles of wine later and the sun's gone down, it's cold, you're absolutely hammered. You know, you've forgotten about, you know, that's just a snippet in time that was particularly amazing. And I think I wrote about in one of my blogs that I posted today, you know, why don't we go, oh, the sun's out, I could just sit there and feel the sun on my skin. Why does it have to be associated with a massive bottle of rosé? But that's what we've been used to. Sun's out, get the wine out. That's what it's always been.
Christmas or wedding.
Anything, yeah.
Okay, I mean, we're coming out, we've got a few minutes left. What would you say, what can you share with people who are thinking that, well, firstly, actually, let me backtrack. What's problem drinking to you?
Well, as I said, I think if you're questioning the way that you drink or you're thinking your drinking is a problem, then there probably is a problem. I think there's a lot of people who have got some kind of issue with alcohol, whether they like to think about it or not. If you personally are questioning it, then there's probably a little bit of an issue there.
Hmm. I mean, I think a lot of people think problem drinking is not remembering how you got home, or, well, actually worse than that. I think a lot of people thought maybe drinking in the morning, drinking every day, drinking spirits is another funny one. I never drank spirits, I was never that bad. Alcohol's alcohol. I actually think a problem drinking is quite different. If you lose your phone after a glass and a half of wine, it's a problem. If you send a text you wish you hadn't after half a beer, it's a problem.
Yeah.
You know, that kind of thing. It's not the quantity of alcohol, it's where it leaves you. Yeah. So it doesn't matter if it was spirit or wine or beer or whatever it was or how much it was, but if you're losing things, to a savings you wish you had, if your relationships are being affected, if you're not getting enough done in the day, if you're not getting into work or your energy's, you know, really low, that's a problem. So what would you, based on your 9 months of experience, and I can chip in with my experience, but what would you suggest that people think about or do if they're worried about their drinking or any of their behaviours, you know, substitute drinking for gambling, smoking, overeating, overworking is a huge one as well, you know, kind of underlook that. What would you suggest people do?
Well, there is help out there. There's some really good sites that I belong to, Team Sober UK and Club Soda. And they've been massive supports to me. So they are private sites, so anything that you write on there, other people can't see. And so a lot of people kind of go on there and say that, you know, if they feel they've got a problem, they go on there and there's lots of support. You're not on your own, basically. I think that's the main thing, is people feel that they're on their own, that they're the only one with a problem, but actually there's a lot of us out there. And like you say, it's not, you know, some people say, oh, you're just a binge drinker. Well, it was a problem for me. I didn't like the fact that one drink led to a whole weekend of being sick. I don't think that's normal, personally, although I did think it was normal at the time. Oh, you know, that's just what happened. I think there's lots of help out there. You can go to AA. It doesn't, you know, people don't get on. Not everybody gets on with AA. There's Smart Recovery as an alternative. There's lots of, all the time. There's things that are coming up because this sober thing is becoming a bit of a revolution. You know, the more we put the word out there, the more people are joining the groups. You know, my blog is just showing how many people there are out there, and that's just for the people that have clicked the button. There's lots of people reading it that are thinking, I can relate to that.
Mm. That leads me to my last question, actually. Do you think you have better connections with people now you're sober?
Haven't really thought about that. I've always been quite a social person anyway. I think the connections are more real. I think that I remember everything. So it's like, you know, you are going to connect better with people because you can actually remember the last time you saw them, you know. Obviously, I've made lots of connections through the different sites that I belong to and through the blog and through being recommended and things like that. So, you know, it's a massive network, if you like, at the moment. I mean,
deeper connections, more intimate connections, because one of the reasons I drank is to create intimacy. I don't mean in sections.
Yeah, but I think you were very different. You drank for a very different reason.
Oh yeah, I don't think it's individual, but I wondered if you got a...
Because I've always been quite... I was going to say intimate, but it just sounds like really wrong. Haven't I? You know, I've been a lot more open, you know, hence doing the blog, I suppose. I think a problem shared is a problem halved, whereas you were very different. You know, you wouldn't necessarily have done this kind of thing at the time. So I think we're very different with that. No, I wouldn't have said that connections have changed for me as such, because I think I was always pretty the same anyway. Mm. I just stopped crying. That's the only massive difference.
That's
everybody's
nice.
Having a small party.
So give us three things that are really stood out for you. We'll finish on that.
The fact that if you don't drink a bottle of wine when you go to when you lose weight at your slimming club, the weight does actually stay off. That's pretty amazing. That there are lots and lots of lovely people out there that I'm so happy to have met. You know, via the blog. That you know, had I not decided to give up drinking, write about it, go on social media, you know, it's all. And I really believe that. You know, everything happens for a reason. All the people I'm in touch with, it's all for a reason. And if I help one person, then, you know, that's great.
Mm. And the third thing.
I love my walking and my podcasts. You know, podcast. I remember people saying, if you listen to my podcast, I was like, I don't even really know what they're talking about. Now I'm absolutely addicted, and I'm on one. I'm not on one, I'm on a couple. I'm absolutely addicted. I went to France recently and ended up walking 8 miles just to finish a podcast that I was listening to. That is very unheard of, isn't it? Yes. Bear in mind, I never used to move off my sunbed. So yeah, that's quite a massive difference.
Yeah, brilliant. Well, I mean, three great things to leave us on, but I'll link to the things you talked about in the show notes. So Club Soda, Team Soda UK, your blog, which is?
It's The Sober Fish Story on Facebook and www.soberfish.co.uk.
Cool, and we'll link to that in the show notes. I'll also link to AA and Smart if anyone's interested in connecting with that. Dawn, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay, so for anyone who's watching on Facebook Live, we will take questions. We've got 5 or 6 minutes for questions. Jump on if you've got any questions, if you're watching, you want to ask Dawn or myself anything to do with alcohol or giving up or any of the things that you've seen in this, shoot us a question in the comments section. We've got some from earlier. How do you stay focused in social situations?
I go early and I go home early. Yeah. So yeah, that's my rule these days is, yeah, I'll go early, but I'll soon shoot off. I think after about 10 o'clock anyway, nobody notices if I'm there. So yeah, I'm safely at home.
I'm the same. So I go early, I leave early, and I always make sure I've got a vehicle, which you always have anyway.
Oh, that's another good thing that I really love is the whole taxi debacle doesn't exist anymore.
Yeah.
Of fighting for a cab,
yeah,
getting a cab, working out where you are, working out where you need to go, handing over. I mean, I haven't got a cab in all that time, and I don't miss cabs. Mm. Yeah, I love the fact you've got your car and you just, whenever you want, you just go somewhere. It's brilliant.
Yeah. But it takes a bit more of that, doesn't it, to focus in a social situation. You've got to be mindful of not getting swept into, you know, the atmosphere a bit. You've got to keep working at it as well as going early.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, I think for me, I don't mind being around alcohol as such. It's more of the people and how much they've had to drink.
Yeah.
You know, so I can sit on a table and everybody's drinking. It doesn't bother me at all anymore. But once people have got to a level and they're not interested in conversing, there's not really a lot of point me being there. In a podcast that I listened to, someone said, the reason you go to a pub is to drink alcohol. So why would you want to go to a pub if you don't drink alcohol? And I think that's really good. Okay, you can go to a pub and drink non-alcoholic drinks, but I used to go to a pub to get pissed.
Mm.
So there's no point in me going to a pub anymore because my main focus of being there has been taken away.
Yeah.
So that's my kind of rule. And if there's food there, I'll stay for a lot longer.
Mm.
But if there's no food, there's no interest really.
Okay, cool. What was day one like? Was another question we had.
So day one, I had the flu. So it's really hard for me to say, but the flu coming at that particular time was stress related. It was like my body was shutting down on me, to be honest. I mean, I couldn't get up, I couldn't get out of bed, I just felt absolutely awful. So a lot of people ask me about day one, but I don't see it as a true day one, really, because I just felt like, you know, I didn't even want to eat anything, didn't want to do anything, couldn't move. So it's not a very realistic day one. But, you know, I suppose once I'd come out of that, I went straight into Christmas, you know, alcohol fest. And that was hard, you know. Christmas was hard because Christmas, all your Christmases revolve around alcohol, and yeah, it wasn't easy. New Year's Eve, I did stay out, I think, till 1:30, but that was only because it took me an hour and a half to round the four people I had to take home because they had to say goodbye to each other about 200 times. So that was the latest night I think I've had in 9 months. And I don't plan to do it again this year, I would say.
You never learn.
Yeah.
The other question we have is around challenges, which I think you answered, really, the challenges that you faced. So if we don't have anything else, okay. Anyone who's watching this, be on Facebook Live if you're watching it after it's been recorded, and you've got questions, your blog again is?
It's the Facebook, The Sober Fish Story, and the website is www.soberfish.co.uk.
Okay, and the last thing, if you're interested in working out what your health IQ is, jump on our website, www.bodyshopperformance.com. There's a little box on the homepage that says, what's my health IQ? Click take the test, and it'll take you through a short 3 or 4 minute quiz and give you some results at the end of that on which aspects of your health to work on. So that includes sleep, mental health, body composition, energy, fitness, and digestion. Other than that, thank you very, very much for watching. Have a good evening.
Thank you.
Thank you.